Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's seminar in Ukrainian studies. My name is Emily Channel Justice, and I'm the director of the Temerty Contemporary Ukraine program at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. I'm delighted that you're here with us today. I know that everybody has been watching, holding their breath, looking at what's going on in Ukraine. And it's overwhelming and it's upsetting. And I just really thank everyone for taking the time to come to this event to learn something more about Ukraine. I think it's really essential that we do what we can to highlight expert voices and to listen to the people who have been doing the research to understand Ukraine for the past, you know, many years, 30 years since Ukraine's independence. And in particular, today's discussion is focusing on Ukraine's multi-ethnic makeup. So not only do we have someone who's an expert on, you know, the fact that Ukraine is a country, something that is currently at threat, but someone who can really tell us a lot about Ukraine's makeup and background, and so how we can understand how important this is for Ukraine's self-identity today. So I'm delighted to be joined by Volodymyr Kulyk, who is head research fellow at the Institute of Political and Ethnic Studies at the National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine. He's also taught at Columbia University, Stanford, and Yale here in the US, Kyiv Mohyla and Ukrainian Catholic University in Ukraine. And he's had research fellowships here at Harvard, Stanford, University College London, University of Alberta, and the Woodrow Wilson Center. Today's talk is entitled, Is Ukraine a Multi-Ethnic Country? Professor Kulyk, I will turn it over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here. Glad it is still possible to talk about academic matters. Actually, I was starting to doubt whether it was an appropriate topic when I was first approached by Huri and invited to give this talk. I thought, okay, this might be a provocative topic. I had this article forthcoming in Slavic Review, and I thought it was interesting enough to attract a relatively large audience. But then somebody outprovoked me, and everything became so provocative that my topic, my research looked pale in comparison, and I was wondering whether it might be prudent to postpone it until more settled times. But then Emily assured me that it is still relevant, it is still appropriate to talk about such things. So let me try to explain why what I am going to talk about directly relevant to what Putin is talking about, to what everybody is now talking about. What do I do to move on with my, doesn't seem to be working. So what it is really about? It is about Putin's claim to defend, to protect Russians in Ukraine and Russian speakers in Ukraine. So I'm gonna ask, are there Russians in Ukraine? Are they distinct from Ukrainians? Do they believe that they are not Ukrainians, just Russians? And beyond their own beliefs, are they encouraged by the state, by the parties, by institutions to behave Russian? Are they taught how to be Russian? And to the extent that it's not only about Russians, even though this confrontation seems to be primarily about Russians, we know that at least we knew that there were other ethnic minorities. Are they different from Russians in this respect? What about Hungarians or Crimean Tatars or Jews? Yeah. So I will mostly focus on Russians, but I will make some comparative observations about other minorities. So it seems like this is a strange question. Of course, Ukraine is multi-ethnic. Yeah. Of course, there are Russians. Of course, there are Jews and Moldovans and Crimean Tatars. We have censuses for that. I present this data from the two last censuses, the last Soviet census of 1989 and the first and only so far post-Soviet census of 2001. And we see the percentages. Yeah, we see the numbers. And numbers do not seem to be lying. Yeah, we have the majority of the titular group of Ukrainians in both censuses. We have a largest minority of Russians. The numbers are decreasing significantly, but it is still a very large share of the population who are believed to be, rather than to consider themselves only or to feel or whatever, to be Russians. And there are also Belarusians and Jews and Moldovans. We see the numbers are changing. So these groups are not stable. So they can be decreasing, except for Ukrainians. Most groups are, between the two censuses decreased in relative numbers and in absolute numbers. Only Crimean Tatars increased. Yeah. But still, no. Even though the numbers were visibly changing, and one of the kind of shocking titles of a Ukrainian media publication about 2001 census was the quarter of Russians have somewhere disappeared. Yeah, they didn't even wonder where exactly could 3 million of Russians disappear. But that didn't lead the authors to question the very existence of Russians as a group. Yeah, they are still there. They are fewer, but they are still there. Since then, as we know, there has been no census. We are told that it will be in 2023, but with this craziness, we are not sure again that it will happen indeed. In the meantime, we only have survey data. Survey data are a bit different. People ask different questions. The context is different, but still we have people identifying, saying they are Ukrainians by nationality or Russians by nationality or Belarusians or Moldovans or whatever. So the numbers for all other groups are too small. So we cannot reliably present separate numbers for every group. It is within the margin error. So we are presenting them here in the right column as other cumulative category. But we have two other groups. And in this survey, there was an option both Ukrainian and Russian. So we have Ukrainians, Russians, those who say they are both, and then everybody else. Yeah. We see, again, the number of Ukrainians, the share of Ukrainians has increased, the share of Russians has decreased, but still it is 5% or something like that. Of course, the margin of error, so it's anything from 3 to 7%, but it is still something like 2 million people, yeah? So when I'm asking whether there are Russians in Ukraine, I'm asking about the meaning of these survey responses and likely census responses. Yeah, so some people say they are Russians. What exactly does it mean? And what it means for their identification and for their attachment to Ukraine and for their attachment to Ukrainianness and for the boundary between Russians and Ukrainian in Ukrainians, yeah, in Ukraine and beyond Ukraine. So this is what I'm going to talk about in my lecture. So let me start with a few theoretical observations. First, I will outline two meanings, two widespread meanings of multi-ethnicity in scholarly literature. The traditional meaning of multi-ethnicity is scholarly similar to lay meaning of multi-ethnicity. So it is a coexistence of numerous clear-cut ethnic groups, like in that table, yeah? There are Ukrainians, Russians, Jews, Crimean Tatars, Hungarians, and so on. So the size of groups may be changing. Some may, members may be not having all attributes. For example, some are not speaking the language of the group, some are not practicing the religion of the group, some are not wearing the clothes associated with the group, but that doesn't mean that they're not of the group, yeah? They're still Ukrainians, or Crimean Tatars, or Russians. Groups are nevertheless considered to be real. This belief of coexistence of clear-cut groups is reflected in the talk of ethnic composition, yeah, like that table. Certain percentages of the population belong to that group, to that group. And then if we look at the composition of the population, we can see a certain degree of what scholars call ethnic diversity or heterogeneity or fragmentation, yeah? And different countries, different societies are different in that degree of diversity or fragmentation. And mostly social scientists believe diversity or fragmentation is bad. Fragmentation actually is kind of loaded term, is bad for social development, for stability, for economic growth, and so on. So the more homogeneous, the less diverse ethnically the country is, the better for its development. Yeah, but still, many countries are diverse and some are extremely diverse, like if you think of Indonesia or some countries in Africa, yeah? So we know they are different from Iceland or for that matter from Ukraine. So that's a traditional meaning of what is multi-ethnic country or society, yeah? The new, recent, more sophisticated understanding is that multi-ethnicity is diversity of ethnic identifications and manifestations. There are not necessarily certain clear-cut groups of people belonging to different nationalities or ethnicities or whatever, but people behaving, identifying differently to the extent belonging to certain, believing that they belong to certain groups, believing that they are of certain ethnicity or certain nationality in post-Soviet parlance, yeah? So we can talk about different salience of ethnic identification. People can believe that they are Ukrainians or Russians, but do not attach the same importance to that perceived belonging, yeah? We can talk about different permeability of ethnic boundaries. Some boundaries are strong and rigid, and some are porous, yeah? We can talk even about different degree of groupness associated with certain ethnic categories, like Crimean Tatars, I would say, have a higher degree of groupness, are more of a group than Russians in Ukraine, or Belarusians, for example, or Hungarians are more of a group than Poles, yeah? So because they have certain clear identifications, certain clear institutions guarding those identifications, certain actors pursuing kind of safeguarding those boundaries and so on. So in addition to situational variation, in some situations people feel that, and in some situations rather that, this different degree of groupness and different salience of identifications result from long-term group making efforts of certain important actors, yeah? And first and foremost, the state. The state is the most important boundary making an actor. It can support certain groups and prosecute or discourage belonging to other groups. For example, in the Russian Empire, belonging to Ukrainians was discouraged, and in Nazi Germany, belonging to Jews was prosecuted. Yeah. Certain groups could be just promoted, could be just supported in their identification, in their boundary making, and certain could be discouraged and hindered. In addition to that, the state could place greater or less emphasis on ethnic boundaries as such. So to present ethnicity as important or not important. And different states behave differently in this respect. We can talk about different strengths of institutionalization of ethnic boundaries. So either there are strong institutions safeguarding ethnic boundaries, or institutions neglect ethnic boundaries, actually try to contribute to their erosion. Yeah. We could distinguish between two kinds of institutions in terms of their role in shaping ethnic boundaries. The first kind is those determining the membership in the political community and in ethnic community. Yeah. Citizenship and immigration institutions. Yeah, either everybody or both the majority and minorities belong to the nation, or only majority belongs to the nation and minorities do not. Immigration is allowed only for ethnic majority members, or also for ethnic minority members. The second kind of institutions are those determining expression of ethnic identity. Here belong ethnic categories in censuses, are they recognized or not, ethnic territorial autonomy allowed or not, ethnic-based affirmative action rather than support of some group or prosecution of other groups. Both can contribute to strengthening of ethnic identification. Ukraine inherited its multi-ethnicity and perception of multi-ethnicity first and foremost from the USSR. Which was a rather exceptional state in terms of the strength of institutionalization of ethnicity. The USSR clearly promoted ethnic identification, supported and instituted clear boundaries, and actually these policies resulted in rather high degree of groupness among first and foremost, titular nations of the Union Republics, but also of some lower level autonomies. There were two dimensions of this institutionalization. First, the territorial dimension. The Soviet Union was nominally a federation of so-called national republics, so republics which were seen as republics for particular ethnic groups. And a personal dimension. Every citizen was assigned a certain category of nationality, yeah, either Ukrainian or Jew or Crimean Tatar or first and foremost Russian. There were two different periods of two main different periods of Soviet history in terms of attitude policy with regard to multi-ethnicity. First, there was extreme diversity of the 1920s, where the regime promoted as many groups as possible, encouraged everybody to kind of reveal or even invent their own original ethnicity, believed to be primordial. And in starting mid-30s, the regime reduced the number of groups which was recognized and kind of assimilated others into larger groups. And change the policy with regard to Russians. While in the 20s, Russians were kind of downplayed a bit in terms of their ethnic identity, and identity of non-Russians group was promoted primarily. Starting mid-30s, Russians were recognized as the first among equal, and their ethnic roots and ethnic culture and ethnic pride was promoted first and foremost. At the same time, so this policy, of course, strongly preserved or even created and preserved, safeguarded ethnic boundaries, so ethnic consciousness of major groups, including Ukrainians. But at the same time, there were some policies weakening boundaries. First and foremost, large-scale migrations, which drove many people out of their national republics. There was linguistic classifications, particularly in the cities, which removed linguistic barrier between titulars and Russians. So everybody, like if you look at Donetsk or even Kyiv, almost everybody spoke Russian in those cities. So there was no clear boundary linguistically that contributed to the erosion of ethnic boundary as well. And finally, mixed marriages, which were extremely widespread and eroded boundaries between two groups because so many people were kind of both. If you look at Soviet Ukraine, this was one of the most striking example of this erosion of ethnic boundaries already in the Soviet times. On the one hand, there were, in addition to traditional minorities living for centuries on certain territories, there was increasing number of Russians and other migrants from other parts of the USSR. In the last Soviet census, there were 22% of Russians in Ukraine as a whole, but 44% in the Donbass and 67% in Crimea. Yeah. In addition to the large presence of ethnic Russians, of people who were Russians by nationality, as they believed and declared in censuses, there was linguistic Russification of Ukrainians. In the last census, of 1989, 12% of those who identify as Ukrainians by nationality declared Russian to be their native language. The figure was as high as 40% in the Donetsk Oblast, for example, 47% in Crimea. But that was about native language. And native language for some was language of their nationality, for some was language of their childhood, not necessarily language of actual usage. If we talk about actual usage, which was something the Soviet regime did not ask in censuses, but which was revealed starting late 80s and early 90s, revealed in surveys, and the figure was much higher. Nationwide, more than half of the population actually preferred Russian in everyday usage. There was also prevalence of mixed marriages. In 1979 census, 30% of Ukrainian population was in mixed marriages, and more than 50% in the Donbass. So it is really a blurred boundaries between two largest ethnic groups. And it was revealed in widespread identification, not in nationality categories, not as Russians or Ukrainians, but as Soviets or mixed, if that option was allowed. If mixed or both Ukrainian and Russian was not allowed, many people identify as Soviets. There were censuses in early 90s, for example, where that was a plurality choice to be Soviet, because people felt uncomfortable to be only Russians or Ukrainians, especially among Russians that was prevalent. So let's look now at the post-Soviet developments. I'm very briefly describing here boundary making strategies of major actors in Ukrainian politics. Starting with National Democrats of the late 80s and early 90s, they promoted a so-called national revival, which meant de-Russification of Russian speaking, in their parlance, Russified Ukrainians and other minority members. So they were promoting ethnic boundaries. Yeah, so people kind of driving people back to their ethnic roots. Yeah, so as they perceived it. And that would mean that ethnicity is more important than it was under the Soviet times. Ethnic boundaries are more important than under the Soviet times. This strategy was, of course, meant to make Ukrainians larger ethnically than they were linguistically. Yeah, so if they would come back, so they would be a clear majority, and then they would have the right to self-determine as a nation and create their own state. Yeah. In contrast, communist nomenklatura promoted people of Ukraine, united ethnically, heterogeneous, but determined by their territorial belonging, and juxtaposed them with the Union Center, which was supposed to rob them. Yeah, so this strategy of strengthening the identity of people of Ukraine, territorial civic identity, worked splendidly in the 1991 referendum, where 90% of those participating in the referendum supported independence for these people of Ukraine, inclusive civic category, which included people of all nationalities. And then that was reflected in the 1996 constitution, whose preamble said, we, the people of Ukraine, Ukrainian citizens of all nationalities. Yeah, so everybody was belonging. And But starting with 1992 under President Kravchuk, there was some mixture of ethnic element of this national revival element to these people of Ukraine discourse. And the Russian speaking elites of East and South felt excluded and kind of disadvantaged with those policies and with that discourse. And they mobilized their East Southern constituencies as Russian speakers against supposed nationalists from Kyiv and from the Western Ukraine. Then came Orange Revolution, came Yushchenko. And even before the Orange Revolution, in his electoral campaign, he again came back to this kind of civic, ethnically neutral categories. He mobilized those who don't steal, meaning the population, the people, against those who steal, meaning the authorities. Yeah, and that worked in the Orange Revolution. But then again, once in power, similarly to Kravchuk, he added ethnic elements even more resolutely and linguistic element. And the party of regions under Yanukovych responded by counter mobilization of Russian speakers of East and South versus Orange West. Yeah. Then came Euromaidan and Russian aggression. Poroshenko both reflected and strengthened that new spirit of united Ukraine, but with a strong Ukrainian ethnocultural core. And came all these policies of decommunization and linguistic Ukrainization and stronger anti-Russian foreign policy choice and so on. And then finally came Zelensky again. Similarly to Poroshenko, he spoke of Ukrainians as an inclusive category, but he tried to emphasize diversity, that we are Ukrainians, but we are different. Some of us speak Russian, some of us speak Hungarian, some of us are Crimean Tatars who suffer under Russian occupation, but we are all Ukrainians. And he presented this diversity primarily in linguistic terms, maybe still believing that linguistic terms kind of correspond to ethnic terms, but he never emphasized ethnicity as such. Actually, if you look at this list in this slide, we see that after National Democrats, no major actor emphasized ethnic boundaries, ethnic identities. They either emphasized the unity of all Ukrainians, people of Ukraine. First, they didn't call them Ukrainians, they started calling them Ukrainians. Yeah, but meaning civic Ukrainians, all the people of Ukraine. Or they divided them linguistically or regionally, but never ethnically. So, ethnic discourse, ethnic divisions were not popular in Ukrainian policy making. And that is a very important kind of finding about post-Soviet Ukrainian policy, post-Soviet Ukrainian boundary making. So let's now look at institutions. As I mentioned earlier, there are two kinds of institutions, those determining membership in the political community, in the nation, including or excluding minorities, and those encouraging or suppressing the expression of ethnic distinction. Yeah. So if you look at institutions of the Ukrainian state, you should take into account that the original design of institutions was meant to ensure support for independence. Some institutions were created in 1991 in the months between the Declaration of Independence in August and the referendum for independence in December, such as citizenship law. If we look at those institutions, we clearly see they were inclusive. There was automatic citizenship to all residents, and it spoke of people of Ukraine as an inclusive category. Moreover, there was no ethnic criterion in immigration and naturalization. Unlike other post-Soviet countries, states, there was no preference for ethnic Ukrainians in naturalization if they return after that automatic citizenship was granted. On the other hand, in terms of expression, there was recognition of ethnic minorities and their ethnocultural rights. Very early in mid-1992, a new law was adopted on national minorities with all standard set of rights for these groups. They were called national minority rather than ethnic minority, but I will call them ethnic minorities for kind of consistency. Yeah. At the same time, the Ukrainian state did not recognize ethnic territorial autonomy, except for Crimea, which was created earlier, which was kind of product of Soviet policies. It was a restoration of autonomy, which was abolished in the 1940s after the deportation of Crimean Tatars. So it was part of this wave of Soviet restorations of ethnic autonomies. Although the population changed and Crimean Tatars became at that time much less numerous, still there was the feeling that this autonomy should be restored. Yeah, and it was not explicitly ethnic autonomy, although the presence of Russians and Crimean Tatars was recognized, their languages were used as official languages in certain domains and so on. But formally, it was a purely territorial autonomy. In contrast, the attempt by Transcarpathia Hungarians to get their autonomy recognized as an ethnic autonomy was rejected outright by the Kiev government in the late 1991 and never adopted since then. Similarly, the state did not recognize ethnic parties and even regional parties were rejected because the law on the parties required that every political parties be established in 2/3 of Ukraine's oblast, meaning they should all be national parties and parties of groups concentrated in only one part of Ukraine. There were some ways to bypass that, but basically the state did all it could to prevent ethnic parties because they believed that they will be divisive, they will be destructive. Moreover, in terms of recognition of expression of ethnic distinctiveness, the major change was discontinuation of the Soviet practice of registration of nationality in personal documents. So the state since then simply did not know people's nationality. Of course, in some cases, it could be seen from appearance or from language, or but in terms of difference between Russians and Ukrainians, if you look at Russified cities in eastern Ukraine or even Kyiv, there is no distinction, and the state does not know nationality, and the state cannot discriminate on the basis of nationality, simply cannot, even if somebody wants that. So it can only be informed by other kind of criteria, maybe related to nationality, such as language or religion or appearance, ethnic clothes or whatever. But definitely large scale ethnic discrimination was simply impossible. So it was absent. At the same time, having abolished nationality in personal documents, the state preserved nationality question in census. So it still believed that these groups are real and the state should know about them. And the discourse accompanying the census presented the census results as the existence of the of a certain number of Ukrainians, certain number of Russians, certain number of Hungarians, and certain number of Crimean Tatars. And there were discussions why these Russians disappeared or how Ukrainians are getting more numerous and how it is good for the state and so on. That contributed to the salience of ethnic identification. And it would have contributed more if there had been more censuses after that. But for more than 20 years now, there were no censuses. For reasons, I believe, completely unrelated to ethnic problems, to this issue of nationality salience or not salience. But the fact is, there were no censuses, no fresh results, no fresh discussions of ethnic composition. So the notion of these groups existing in Ukraine gradually faded and disappeared virtually from public discourse. In contrast to these fading ethnic boundaries, linguistic boundaries were clearer. First, language has more everyday visibility. Either you speak Ukrainian or Russian or Hungarian, and people, you are kind of practicing this language and asserting this language. Other hear that and perceive you as such by that language. And also, there was a greater political salience of language issue. Starting from early 90s, there were a lot of debates in the parliament, in elections, in political discourse, in media discourse about language issue, and now we still can see it in social media. So language is here as a factor that people perceive kind of relates to people identity and divides or unites the population. So people are divided in their perceptions whether language, whether you can say mowa biedna, language unites, or language divides. Yeah, some people believe that language issue definitely divides Ukrainian population. Yeah, but this is not about ethnicity per se. This is about one characteristic which some believe is closely related to language, and some believe is not so closely related to language, at least in Ukraine. So let's now look at public discourse. Another domain where, another practice where language, where ethnic boundaries can be asserted or eroded. And I'm arguing that in Ukrainian case, they are mostly eroded rather than asserted. My conclusions about ethnic discourse are based on a thorough analysis of political discourse on the example of two practices, President's New Year Eve's addresses and electoral programs of major political parties, as well as on long-term observations, less systematic, but very prolonged observations of media discourse. Started with definitely with early 2000s. So the main finding of this analysis is that the major marker which we could think was ethnic marker is Ukrainians, but this is used in inclusive sense as a civic marker rather than ethnic marker. At the same time, ethnic groups simply do not exist in that discourse. Other ethnic groups are very rarely mentioned. And Ukrainians, a specifically ethnic group rather than civic groups, are also rather rarely mentioned, more and more rarely as independence went on. This trend of inclusive use of Ukraine, of the term Ukrainian, started in early 2000s, first in media discourse, particularly in sports program. If we are talking about Ukrainians playing football against Germans or Russians, yeah, they were all Ukrainians, regardless of their ethnic belonging. And they were Ukrainians, even if some of them were visibly black, for example, in major football clubs. Yeah, but still they were increasingly called Ukrainians as sports team. Maybe less so in clubs, but more in national teams. And this tendency of inclusive use of Ukrainians then shifted to political discourse and then to everyday discourse. It definitely intensifies after 2014. Russians came to mean people in Russia. And after 2014, many people believe these are enemy people. Yeah, and Russians were enemy. And that's why fewer people wanted to identify as Russians, because that was kind of politically incorrect and maybe socially problematic for some. So Russians came to mean people in Ukraine, not a group, people in Russia, not a group in Ukraine. So gradually Russians as a group in Ukraine were discursively erased. They are not present in mainstream discourse in Ukraine. As I said, it is true of political discourse, is it true of institutional media discourse, and it is mostly true of social media discourse, at least those segments of social media discourse I have access to. So Russian speakers as a category of defined by language rather than ethnicity remain present, but it is also less prominent than it used to be in the 90s or early 2000s. Now, the main category which is present in discourse are Ukrainians and Russians who are the perebrikan beyond the border. Yeah, it seems like strange. Ukraine consists only of Ukrainians whose ethnicity is not mentioned, whose ethnicity is perceived to be non-existent or irrelevant, not important. Occasionally, you can see some mention of Crimean Tatars or Hungarians or Jews with regard to certain activities or certain statesmen by them or by their kin states, but very rarely about Russians as an ethnic group. I would say much less than about Crimean Tatars or about Hungarians or about Jews. It is kind of paradoxical because it is still the largest ethnic group beyond apart from Ukrainians, but it is the fact of this public discourse at a time of war with those people who are called Russians, meaning in Russia. So let's move to the third criteria of analysis of the strengths of, and it's a third factor of shaping ethnic boundaries. So I will analyze citizens' identifications by ethnic categories. Of course, I'm relying here on survey data. Yeah, I have access to a lot of surveys. Mostly from Kyiv International Institute of Sociology. I myself, as a team with Western scholars, commissioned a lot of surveys, and we always have this question about nationality and also some other related questions probing into identification of respondents by national ethnic category or national category or linguistic category and salience and so on. And even experiments seeing how flexible, how fluid this identification is. I will only mention some, but let me start with a general observation. At some point in the 2000s, major pulp companies simply stopped publishing ethnic breakdowns of survey responses. If you look at the survey data from 1990s, it is always first the aggregate data for all Ukrainian population, then separately for Ukrainians by nationality, Russians by nationality, then maybe for certain regions, they may be for certain age groups, but always nationality there. Now, never. I even asked representatives of certain survey companies, why you stop so? They try to explain they didn't want to project this impression that the differences are explained by nationality, which is of course politically correct, which is of course kind of socially responsible, but it definitely contributes to this non-existence of nationality in public consciousness. And ethnic groups are not present even if as communities supposedly holding certain opinions. Yeah, so we could still believe that Ukrainians support Zelensky less than Russians or the other way around. Ukrainians want in NATO, Russians want more to be united with Russia or something. Yeah, we do not hear that. We do not know what these supposedly clear-cut groups have. So we do not believe there are such clear-cut groups. We simply forget about their existence. We believe that Ukrainians are one group and they are called Ukrainians. Yeah. If you look, nevertheless, at this data by nationality, I have access to them, even though they're not published, but those surveys I commissioned myself, I have access and I can analyze them over the years and in terms of regions and so on. So we definitely see steady increase of share of Ukrainians by nationality and commensurate decrease of share of Russians, especially after 2014, but it didn't start there, it was gradual. So this is partly the inertia of independence. Yeah, so in all countries, there is kind of ambiguity in the use of terms, French or Germans or Americans, are they ethnic or are they civic? Mostly civic, even though of course, some people believe they're ethnically German, or they are Americans, meaning true Americans, white and Saxon Protestant or Protestant or whatever. Yeah, but this ambiguity of the term always works to the effect of eroding boundaries between majority and other groups, because everybody becomes Ukrainian or German or French. If you look at kind of evolution of identifications, I will show it you in the next slide, we can see that many people, I call them ethnic Russians, many people who first identify as Russians by nationality, first added Ukrainian identification, so became both, and then substituted Ukrainian identification for Russian one, so became Ukrainian only. At the same time, if you look at the more kind of complex questions, more sensitive questions about identification, we see that most of those who say they are Russians by nationality also to some extent identify as Ukrainian. So they are not only Russians. They, one of the questions I asked at the very beginning, are those people who are Russians do not consider themselves Ukrainian? No, the answer is no. Most of them also consider themselves Ukrainian. And at the same time, if so many former Russians have become Ukrainian, not only former Russians, some former Belarusians and some former Jews and some former many others, yeah? But primarily about Russians, we talk simply because it's the largest groups, and survey data, as I mentioned, only give you clear information about Russians because all other groups are so small that you cannot reliably talk about their numbers, their sizes based on survey data. So we can talk that, we can say that the meaning of this Ukrainianness, of this Ukrainian identity also changed. If people who used to be Russians now call themselves Ukrainians, it is not primarily because they are of Ukrainian descent. It is also because of their Ukrainian choice, maybe because of their Ukrainian language or likely because of their Ukrainian conviction, because of their Ukrainian loyalty, yeah? So because of their Ukrainian citizenship. So the meaning of Ukrainian identity shifts from ethnic to civic. So let's see a few illustrations of that. So this is a question of whom do you consider yourself by nationality? In a number of surveys from 2012 to 2021, and we see that the share of Ukrainians increases, the share of Russians decreases. In 2014, the share of both Ukrainian and Russian increased. So like I said, many Russians first added Ukrainian identification, so became both Ukrainian and Russian, and then dropped Russian nationality and became Ukrainian only. Still, we can see that this process stabilized now, and in 2017 and 2021, the share of Russians is virtually the same. So, like I said, something like 5% probably now, but the share of both here decreased again. So if we ask a more detailed question, so, Kyiv International Institute of Sociology has this practice. After asking about how you identify by nationality, who do you consider yourself by nationality? It asks those who say they are Ukrainian, Russian, or both, they ask a follow-up question. Let me call here. Follow-up question, saying them to say the shades, kind of the scale, Ukrainian only, both Ukrainian and Russian, but more Ukrainian, equally Ukrainian and Russian, both Ukrainian and Russian, but more Russian, and Russian only. And we can see that a considerable percentage displays this kind of mixed identity, yeah, with more Ukrainian or equally, especially the kind of 16% almost, yeah? But remarkably, while for those identifying as Ukrainians, these shares of mixed identification are really small in comparison to purely Ukrainian identification. For those saying their nationality is Russian, only half of them, 48%, say they are Russian only, while the others display different degrees of mixed identity or even purely Ukrainian identity. So if asked about their nationality, they will give you kind of predictable answers, though the social knowledge of their being Russian by nationality. But if you ask about the nuances of their identification, 7.5% of them will say they are Ukrainian only. So that's how they feel. And 19% of them say they are equally Ukrainian and Russian. So only half of them would say they are Russians and not Ukrainian at all. Yeah. So let's check about, let's talk about their responses to the question of how they determine their nationality. I gave them, in at least three surveys, I gave them this table, the choice of by nationality of my parents, by the country I live in, by the language I speak, and by my attitude towards this nation. Yeah, we see that the large majority still determines their nationality by nationality of their parents, even though a quarter now determines by civic criteria, by the country they live in. And this share has increased considerably after 2014. Yeah. Still, the very fact that the clear majority says that they define their nationality by nationality of parents testifies to the strengths of this predominant discourse, that nationality is about descent. Yeah, nationality is something you inherit rather than you choose. Even though, of course, the increased number of people who say they are Ukrainians means that they are not choosing, they are really choosing rather than inheriting Ukrainian nationality. But if asked, did you choose? They say, no, I inherited. So that's the dominance of the prevalent discourse about nationality matters. And finally, this is an illustration of unequal salience of markers of ethnicity and language for different parts of the population. So there is this question, which of the following words best characterizes you? And people are given the list of 20 words. I only present some of them so as not to have a too long and confusing table. And they are allowed to choose no more than three. And we see that Ukrainian is the preeminent identification. So 45% of the population in 2021 believe that Ukrainian identity best characterizes, the word Ukrainian best, one of the words best characterizing them. And it is much more than gender identification, man or woman, or religious identification as Orthodox, or social identification as pensioner. Yeah, but if we compare these lists of priorities for those who say their nationality is Ukrainian and for those who say their nationality is Russian, we see a very different picture. For Ukrainians, Ukrainian identity is still preeminent. And the difference in its salience between Ukrainian and gender region is huge. Yeah, 49% versus 20 or versus 17 for Orthodox and 15 for pensioner. For Russians, in contrast, not only is the salience of Russian identity or Russian speaker identity is much lower, 29% and 25%, but also it is comparable to other identifications, so Orthodox and pensioner. So we see that pensioner is 30% and Russian 9%, so statistically equivalent. So we see that Russian identity is not the most salient identity for people who say they are Russians. So they believe they are Russians, those 5%, much fewer than they used to be, but it doesn't mean that they are defined primarily by this nationality. So it is no more salient than their social identifications, their religious identification. It is just one of many things about them. They do not necessarily think of themselves primarily as Russians. In conclusion, what I hope I have demonstrated is that the widespread perception of Ukraine as a multi-ethnic country is clear boundaries between ethnic groups is inadequate. I have shown that in the post-Soviet period, the boundary between people formerly categorized as Ukrainians and Russians has almost disappeared. I would say provocatively that in a way, it is Putin's dreams. Russians and Ukrainians are one people, except they call themselves Ukrainians. They call Russians enemy people or distant people, foreign people. They do not consider themselves Russian, and they do not consider they are the same as Russians. Yeah, but the boundary internally in Ukraine between Ukrainians and Russians is weak at best. Ukrainian state, the main reason of that erosion of boundary is that Ukrainian states abandoned Soviet institutional and discursive mechanism of the reproduction of ethnic distinctiveness. It worked most vividly with regard to Russians, but if you look at other groups, unfortunately, I didn't have time to talk. Some other groups remain more distant and more visible, such as Crimean Tatars, because of their political activities and their suffering under Putin's regime in Crimea. Hungarians, because of the activities of the Hungarian state in support of ethnic Hungarians in Ukraine. Some groups remain more visible than Russians, but generally in ethnic discourse, all markers of ethnicity are very kind of fading. We can see that Russian identity, to the degree it still remains, has low salience for people who say their nationality is Russian. At the same time, although Ukrainian identity is preeminent, its meaning has shifted from purely ethnic or predominantly ethnic to significantly to civic to considerable extent, maybe even primarily civic. To most people, we cannot strictly compare, but I would say even primarily civic meaning Ukrainian identity now has. So we can conclude that there are no clear-cut groups, but that doesn't mean that Ukrainian population is homogeneous ethnically, culturally. So in this sense, my question was provocative. Is Ukraine a multi-ethnic country? We should say how multi-ethnic is Ukraine. In what sense there is multi-ethnicity in Ukraine? And I will tell you, the sense is the diversity of ethno-cultural identifications and manifestations. Although very few people in Ukraine now consider themselves only Russians and not at all Ukrainians, but some people believe they are both Russians and Ukrainians. Some people believe that they are Ukrainians, but their native language is Russian. Some people even say their native language is Ukrainian, but speak mostly Russian or practice Russian culture more than Ukrainian culture. In addition to Ukrainians and Russians, there are many people who combine these identifications and practices to varying degrees. In addition to Ukrainian, Russians, and those mixing the two identifications and manifestations, there are other groups which are more or less visible and more or less kind of persistent. Yeah, I mentioned a few of them, but there are many others. So Ukraine is clearly ethno-culturally diverse, and I consider this characteristic, this label, is more adequate to characterize Ukraine than multi-ethnic. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. I think you've given us a lot to think about. So for our audience, please do submit your questions via the Q&A and I'll read them out, but I'll start. I have a lot of kind of thoughts in response, but I think one thing that you've pointed out that's so interesting is the way that the independent state of Ukraine has taken this idea of ethnicity, shifted it from the Soviet definition, and then what your data does is look at how people think about their own identity, which is a completely different way of thinking about ethnic identity than the Soviet model, which was this very, you know, as most Soviet things, right, top down and imposed from above. So I am not sure if that's much of a question, but one of the things that I was also thinking about was the question of regionalism. It came up a couple of times, and so I wonder, have you first of all done any research on how people identify regionally within Ukraine? Do they, in your questions about one of the later slides where you showed the word that best describes people, do people ever choose regions that describe them? Is that a salient identity? And does regionalism sometimes get substituted for an ethnic explanation now that we're not, you know, always differentiating our data by ethnicity?
Thank you. Actually, my list of questions had regional identification. So in the list, I included local identification, resident of my city or village. Yeah, but there was also a question, an option, resident of my region. Yeah, and it was somewhere twice as less popular as locality. So local identity always prevailed, but regional identity was more popular in the 90s and then gradually decreased its salience. And it was popular in the Donbass, for example, but also in Galicia. It was more popular in the Donbass precisely because for major political actors such as the Party of Regions promoted that identity. It says yes, you are residents of Donbass, and Donbass will not submit, and Donbass will not be brought to its knees and so on. Yeah, so they were taught to think of themselves as people of the Donbass rather than Ukrainians, and particularly because Party of Regions didn't want to promote strong Ukrainian identity, yeah? And at the same time, this regional kind of distinction and regional emphasis prevented from the consolidation of a united Russian or Russian-speaking identity in Ukraine. One of my kind of objection to David Layton's idea of the promotion of Russian-speaking identity, yeah, was that it could not be promoted as a Ukraine-wide Russian-speaking identity precisely because major political actors stressed the regional dimension. The Donbass Russian speakers were primarily taught that they were people of Donbass rather than they were Ukraine's Russian speakers. Yeah, and that meant that this Russian speakingness had different shades in different parts of Ukraine. Yeah, so there was no consolidation of unified identity.
That is really fascinating, and I think that's a really significant conclusion there, because one of the things that, you know, many scholars now are looking at is precisely what is regionalism in Ukraine today, and one of the things again that you've been speaking about some is this kind of politicized component of some of these policies. So I think that answer is fascinating. We have a couple of questions here about your data in particular. Patrice Dabrowski is wondering if in your 2021 survey, were you able to go into the occupied territories? Do you have data from the occupied territories? And if not, you know, what maybe do you think that might have told you that would be different?
No, unfortunately, I don't have data from occupied territories since 2014. And the data I show, they are all from currently Ukraine-controlled territories. So if I had different territories, the data would be uncomparable. So I always remove those respondents from territories and currently not under Ukraine control from early data. For example, if I show 2012 data, I exclude Crimea and the occupied parts of the Donbass. Yeah, but most Ukrainian poll companies do not work with occupied territories, and there is a large question of reliability of the data. And actually, the first publication of data from the occupied territories by German Center for International Security for Ost-European and International Affairs, SOIS, yeah, created kind of an outcry in Ukraine how can you present the data as if they were real? Yeah, and I do not know how distorted those data are by the undemocratic regime and by lack of safety. Many people might feel in expressing their opinions. Yeah, so whether they ideally they should refuse, but many would not refuse, but just give politically correct answers. Yeah, those the regime expects, and that will undermine the quality of data significantly. So we should analyze this data because we need something. Yeah, something is better than nothing, but we cannot just pretend this data are of the same quality as in Ukrainian territory or in Russia proper, because when there is stable authority and people are not prosecuted without without court, without without any democratic procedure, simply many people might be too frightened to express their opposition or, for example, their Ukrainian identification. So we just don't know how correct, how quality this data is. So I only have data from Ukraine-controlled territories.
Yeah, I think that's really important for us all to keep in mind, the difficulty of doing good research and authentic research there. We have just one other question about your data itself from Rosanna Westerlund, who is curious about the how rural populations are represented. Do you have any information about the percentage of responses of rural populations and the geographic areas that are represented in your data?
I remember that in most surveys, the share of rural population is roughly 1/3. So that corresponds to their share in Ukraine's population. But we should keep in mind that people migrate, and it is very hard for sociologists to make their sample to reflect the patterns of settlement, given that so many people are registered in one place, actually live in another place, work in yet another place. Yeah. So I rely on Kyiv as one of the most reputable Ukraine poll companies. I do not personally make this design these samples. I do not know how to, and I trust them completely. But I must say that all sociologists complain that the lack of new census create a huge problem. Sociologists simply do not know current distribution of the population. So they should pattern their sample on the current demographic patterns, yeah? Urban, rural, old, young. They simply don't know. And they, for example, they notice a considerable difference between face-to-face surveys and phone surveys. But as Volodymyr Panioto, director of Kyiv, mentioned, we would like to know which is more correct. But for that, we need a census to know the distribution of the population. And since there is no census, we simply can register. There are two different trends, and we report them truthfully. But we cannot say which is closer to the actual population distribution.
Yes, that is a really, really important question for everybody. We have a lot of questions kind of about the survey itself, but I think that's really essential. I want to turn to a couple of questions that we have coming from Canada. So Natalia Kananko-Friesen, she says Canada embraced a multicultural model for its nation's involvement, and that policy allowed for ethnic groups to assert themselves as standalone cultural groups. And so she's wondering about the Ukrainian ethnic landscape, where we see the efforts of some ethnic groups to lobby for more recognition. So do you have policies that you suggest where Ukraine could embrace this harmonious ethnic plurality? And then relatedly, Michael Schul asks kind of about the idea of multiculturalism. Is that something similar? He's coming from a kind of multiculturalism in Canada perspective. Is that something that could help Ukraine, or a policy that could be implemented, or a way of looking at Ukraine that would be useful in your opinion?
First, let's keep in mind that Ukrainian ethnocultural composition was originally very different from that of Canada or the UK, for example, or other Western countries. So if in Canada you could see Ukrainian and Italian and Indian and Chinese living nearby, such extreme diversity of groups was not present in Ukraine. So you could see Crimean Tatars and Russians and Ukrainian living in Simferopol, for example, or in Sudak. You could see Ukrainians and Hungarians and Russians and Romanians living in Transcarpathia. But in most parts of Ukraine, the diversity is much lower. Yeah, and the cultural difference between two largest groups, Ukrainians and Russians, is much lower. So they, like I said, in cities they speak the same language predominantly. Uh, they they practice the same religion predominantly, even though the Ukrainian churches were divided, but the divide did not correspond with the ethnic division. Yeah, so many ethnic Ukrainians went to Moscow Patriarchy, and some ethnic Russians went to Kyiv Patriarchy, for example. At the same time, of course, the state could and still can promote ethnic diversity more. And I my finding is that it didn't. Partly because it was electorally disadvantageous to major political parties. It didn't want to divide their constituencies by ethnic criteria. It wanted them all. Or at least it wanted regional parts of it, like party of regions primarily kind of courted the East Southern constituency. Yeah, but it didn't want to exclude ethnic Ukrainians from that part. It wanted to call all of them people from the Donbass or people from the East, and didn't emphasize ethnic division. Similarly, even in Transcarpathia, Hungarian parties, of course, emphasize Hungarianness, but Ukrainian parties didn't want to exclude Hungarians. So in all regions, linguistic divisions also, some people, of course, emphasize Ukrainian language, some people emphasize Russian language, but they never send a clear message that they are only for one part of the population. If they emphasized any division, it was regional and linguistic, but never ethnic. So that was one reason why the state didn't promote ethnic diversity, multicultural to the extent Canadian state, for example, did. Another important reason is that the state promotes ethnic cultural activities of those groups who are strongly pressure, who strongly express their wish to be different. Yeah, if for example, Belarusians. Yeah, the last Soviet census, they were third largest group, almost 1% of the population. That was something almost half a million of people, but they were very very weak in expressing their ethnic distinctions. There were some societies and the state kind of gave them some money for maybe a newspaper or maybe a festival. But since the groups did not pressure, they did not display a strong wish to be ethnically distinct, the state did not do anything about them. They were easy for the state. Yeah. Hungarians were more pressuring, were more insistent, and the Kin state helped them. So the state should take that into account. Should create some conditions. Should give some money. Should grant some recognition of their distinction. So, for example, Jews. They are much less numerous than Belarusians, according to the survey results, census results. But many of them are expressing their distinction much more vigorously than Belarusians. So that's why they are more visible. Their part in Ukraine multi-ethnic or multicultural composition is noticeable. So that depends on the groups, but in general, the state didn't want to do that. And of course, the elephant in the room was the Russians. Yeah, Russians were such a large group that if the state promoted their ethnic distinctions, that would certainly promote ethnic division. And the state didn't want to do that, especially since 2014, but even before that. So, and Russians did not want to strongly emphasize their ethnic distinctions. They wanted to safeguard their language and continue using it. They did so. They had every opportunity to do so, at least until 2014. But ethnic culture, some distinctions from Ukrainians, that's not something most of them seem to be preoccupied with. And the state, of course, didn't facilitate that.
Thank you. We're running short on time. I'm going to ask just one more question that hopefully you can give a nice, succinct answer for Alexander Timchuk, who's in Norway, where he says there's a prominent discussion on Ukraine as a deeply split country. How would you respond to that? Can you give us kind of one brief response?
I can say it's absurd. I showed that there is not only deep divide, There is no divide in effect. There is diversity. Yeah, there was a nice article by Rory Finnan of Cambridge a couple of years ago. Diverse, not divided. Yeah. So Ukraine is ethnoculturally diverse, although to a lesser extent than many countries in the West. Yeah. Let alone in post-colonial world. But it is certainly not divided. It can be politically divided. It can be ideologically divided. Again, it's a question whether Ukraine is more ideologically divided than the US, for example, currently. Yeah, probably less. But it certainly is not ethnically divided.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for answering all these questions. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. I feel like we've all learned so much, and we've got some great new information to take with us. For those of you here today, please join us next week for our next event, which is actually going to take place on Monday, February 28th at 12 p.m. That will be a rapid response panel dedicated to the evolving current situation. And then on Wednesday, March 2nd, also at 12 p.m., we'll continue with our seminar in Ukrainian studies. We'll have Olesya Chromechuk here for a discussion of her book, A Loss, The Story of a Dead Soldier Told by His Sister. Please join me in thanking Professor Kulyk. Thank you so much for your time and for sharing so much of your research with us.
Thank you for this opportunity. It was wonderful to talk and share my research. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.